Good morning, everyone. How are you guys doing this morning? Fantastic. I'm gonna talk a little bit to allow the parents to come back, but I'm gonna talk about some good stuff. One is super excited about the men's gathering. I really think that's gonna be a great time of fellowship together. Don't worry, they're not excited now, but afterwards, you know, it's gonna be amazing. And I'm always encouraged. Every time I hear what the ladies are doing here at Rich Fellowship, I'm always super encouraged. Just reminded of what God is doing in and through our ladies here at Rooted Fellowship. I am tremendously thankful for Jono, who serves as one of the pastors here. He also led the band this morning. But I'm thankful for him for a number of things, and one was for last week. Who was here last week and heard the sermon? My goodness. Do I even have a job yet? I reached out to him and I just said, hey, we've been swimming through the book of Judges for a couple of weeks now, and it's a lot of reading, and I said, man, I'm really exhausted, and I would love to take a break. And he stepped in and preached an unbelievable message. I mean, it was timely, it was full of conviction, full of God's truth, full of God's grace, and I just thought to myself, I could easily sit under that preaching. Just absolutely gifted human being. And thankful for what God is doing here, because wow, Rooted has preachers. It has folks who come up here and open up His Word and boldly and with truth and conviction and just preach God's Word. And I know that it is at work. God's Word is what transforms our hearts. So just really, really thankful for him. I know he's not here. He's probably singing to the kids. So he'll sing here and then walk down there and sing to the kids. And he truly is a gift to this community, a massive blessing. And so if you see him, just give him a word of encouragement. I know he encourages you. His nickname is Barnabas, because I believe he is the son of encouragement. He's always, always encouraging people. And so if you see him, just give him a word of encouragement. Just tell him you're thankful for him. Men, tell him you love him. It's okay for men to say to other men that I love you. We want to normalize that here at Rooted, and be praying for him. Be praying for him and his family. Lifting them up to the Lord. Amen. Amen. We are back in the book of Judges. We left off with the story of Gideon. All right, so Gideon had just had an encounter with God. We first find him in hiding. He's fearful because the Midianites and the Pretoria, the people from the east, let me leave that one alone. The people from the east had taken over, and so he has an encounter with God. God calls him and says, I'm going to deliver you and the nation of Israel. I'm going to rescue you, and I'm going to do it through you. And still, he doesn't believe. And so there's this back and forth conversation that Gideon has with God. And then ultimately, he gets to a point where he is assured that, no, God will do that which he said he will do. We landed the plane with the fleece test, the wool fleece test, that many have used, abused, and have been confused by it for various reasons. It's not a test that we use to figure out what God wants us to do. It's a test that assures us that God is with us, that he will provide for us. And we don't have to do the test anymore the way Gideon did it. We just look to the cross. We can clearly see that God loves us more than we could ever imagine because of the finished work of Jesus. That right now, in this very moment, Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. He's interceding for us. He's praying for us by name and by situation. He has defeated sin, death, and Satan. That is our assurance. That is what we hold on to as we go forth to do that which he has called us to do. And so we ended there with Gideon now ready to go to battle. So we're in chapter 7. And so if you have a Bible, you can meet me in the book of Judges, chapter 7. I am going to attempt to do the impossible this morning. I'm going to try to get us through three chapters, right? Chapter 7, 8, and 9. And so we're going to move really quickly. I'll be watching the clock. If we don't make it, we don't make it. All right? I'm sorry. But I'm going to do my very best. And how we're going to do it is we're going to walk through chapter 7, almost line by line, and then we're going to jump over to chapter 8 and kind of pick out a few verses there that I believe are relevant and helpful for us today. And then I'll summarize chapter 9, Lord willing, just to kind of land the plane on this particular section. All of it has to do with Gideon, and all of it is very, very, very important for us to hear and to understand, all right? So chapter 7 in the book of Judges. Before we jump in, permit me to pray. I'm going to pray for you. I ask that you pray for me, that God would do that which only he can do, and that is save many people. And so, Father, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you that it is living and active, that it continues to transform the human heart. And so, God, would you do that again this morning? We are in desperate need of a Savior, and that Savior has a name. It is Jesus. Help us to fix our eyes on you. Lord, I pray that the words that I have in front of me, my words would submit to your word. Lord, I pray that my heart would submit to yours. We want your will to be done in this place. We love you. We praise you. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Judges chapter 7, verse 1. Jerubbaal, that is Gideon, and all the troops who were with him got up early and camped beside the spring of Harod. The camp of Midian was north of them, below the hill of Moriah in the valley. So they are now strategically placed. They are tactically ready. This is a good plan. Gideon and his men have an advantage of height and possible invisibility. They are well situated to take the enemy by surprise. But we'll see in verse 2 that God has a surprise for them. The Lord said to Gideon, "You have too many troops for me to hand the Midianites over to them, or else Israel might elevate themselves over me and say, 'I have saved myself.'" Like, little shaky, but okay. Verse 3, "Now announce to the troops, 'Whoever is fearful and trembling may turn back and leave Mount Gilead.'" So 22,000 of the troops turned back, but 10,000 remained. And so Gideon's now gone from 32,000 to 10,000 people. I mean, Gideon's probably going, look, we didn't really have that many people in the beginning, but now to be down to 10,000, but maybe he's going, you know what, I'd rather have 10,000 brave men, right, than 32,000 and some of them not so brave. Verse 4, "Then the Lord said to Gideon, 'There are still too many troops.'" I mean, it's at this point that I'm going, God, hold on. Can you see the numbers? God, can you count? How can there be still too many troops? But God says it. He then says to him, "Take them down to the water and I will test them there for you there. I will test them for you there. If I say to you, 'This one can go with you,' he can go. But if I say about anyone, 'This one cannot go with you,' he cannot go." So he brought the troops down to the water, and the Lord said to Gideon, "Separate everyone who laps water with his tongue like a dog," which is super strange, "and then do the same with everyone who kneels to drink." And so here's Gideon watching the men, right? So there's a group that goes over here, and I don't even know how to do this. Like, do you put your face down to the water and then lick it? Like it's super strange. But he watches them, and then the others kneel down and drink water like normal human beings. Verse 6, "The number of those who lapped with their hands to their mouth was 300 men. And all the rest of the troops knelt to drink water." Again, if I was Gideon, I'd go, well, thank goodness, only 300. God, get rid of those 300. Like, who drinks water like that, right? So he's going to get rid of those, and then I'll still have 9,700 men to go to war with. But verse 7 says, "The Lord said to Gideon, 'I will deliver you with the 300 men who lapped and hand the Midianites over to you.'" This is not a good look. Let's be honest. This is like, Gideon's going with those 300, the ones that drank water, like, God, are you sure? But everyone else is to go home. So Gideon sent all the Israelites to their tents, but kept the 300 troops who took the provisions and their ram's horns. The camp of the Midianite was below him in the valley. Verse 9, that night the Lord said to him, "Get up and attack the camp, for I have handed it over to you. But if you are afraid to attack the camp, go down with Purah your servant. Listen to what they say, and then you will be encouraged to attack the camp." So he went. Why did he go? Well, because he was afraid. So he went down with Purah his servant to the outpost of the troops who were in the camp. Now the Midianites, Amalekites, and all the people of the east had settled down in the valley like a swarm of locusts, and their camels were as innumerable as the sand on the seashores. I'm pretty sure Gideon's heart is beating fast. When Gideon arrived there, there was a man telling his friend about a dream. He said, "Listen, I had a dream. A loaf of barley bread came tumbling into the Midianite camp, struck a tent, and it fell. The loaf turned the tent upside down so that it collapsed." His friend answered, "This is nothing less than the sword of Gideon, son of Joash the Israelite. God has handed the entire Midianite camp over to him." When Gideon heard the account of the dream and its interpretation, he bowed in worship. When he heard the interpretation of the dream, he bowed in worship. Interpretation of a word can do mighty things in the hearts of people. This is why we gather every week and we open up God's word and we seek to understand it. Because this has the power to do mighty things in the hearts of people. I think of Thomas, one of Jesus' disciples, after Jesus had resurrected and he was told that Jesus is no longer dead but alive. He was just like, "I don't believe. I don't believe. I want to put my finger in the hole. I don't believe." And so in John chapter 20, verse 28, after putting his finger in the hole, he cries out, "My Lord and my God." He believes. But then listen to what Jesus says in verse 29. "You believe because you have seen me. Blessed are those who believe without seeing." Blessed are those who have not visibly seen Jesus, but through the interpretation of his word, we believe. He returned to Israel's camp and said, "Get up, for the Lord has handed the Midianite camp over to you." Not to me, but to you. Gideon here speaks in the collective. Then he divided the 300 men into three companies and gave each of the men a ram's horn in one hand and an empty pitcher with a torch inside in the other hand. Now, if you're me and you're reading this, I would go, "Where's the sword? We're going to war. We only have 300, but I'm trusting God. But God, where's the sword?" In verse 17, Gideon says this, "Watch me." That's great leadership. "Watch me. I know you're scared, but just watch me and do what I do. When I come to the outpost of the camp, do as I do. And when I and everyone with me blow our ram's horns, you also to blow your ram's horns all around the camp. Then you will say, 'For the Lord and for Gideon.'" Verse 19, "And Gideon and the 100 men who were with him went to the outpost of the camp at the beginning of the middle of the watch." This is around midnight, right? Between midnight and maybe 3 in the morning. "They blew their ram's horns and broke the pitchers that were in their hands. The three companies blew their ram's horns and shattered their pitchers. They held their torches in their left hand and their rams to blow in their right hands, and they shouted, 'A sword for the Lord and for Gideon.' Each Israelite took his position around the camp, and the entire Midianite army began to run, and they cried out as they fled." This is massively confusing at this point, especially for the Midianites. Right? We're told here that it's the beginning of the middle watch. And so you've got one watch making its way back to camp, another watch coming to the outpost, they're transitioning, and then another one that's probably sleeping. But now in all of this chaos, it's like, what's going on? What on earth is going on? You don't expect it at this time. And so they're going, they look back, they hear the noise, they see the light, they hear the shouting, and they're like, what? Gideon must have like tons of men with him. But now the people who are waking up, they're going, they're seeing this and hearing this, but then they're seeing people coming at them. So they pull out their swords and they started, it's chaos. But it's all planned. When Gideon's men blew their 300 ram's horns, and the Lord caused the men in the whole army to turn on each other with their swords. And so they fled to Acacia House in the direction of Zerah, as far as the border of Abel Melohal near Tabath. Then the men of Israel were called from Naphtali, Asher, Manasseh, and they pursued the Midianites. Gideon goes from coward to courage. He steps up as a leader and leads these men with a plan that at first glance doesn't look like it's going to make any sense, but when you put it into action because you're trusting in God, God does the impossible. And so now the Midianites are on the run. Verse 24, Gideon sent messages throughout the hill country of Ephraim with this message. Come down to intercept the Midianites and take control of the watercourses ahead of them as far as Beth-barah and the Jordan. So all the men of Ephraim were called out and they took control of the watercourses as far as Beth-barah and the Jordan. They captured Oreb and Zeb, the two princes of Midian. And they killed Oreb at the rock of Oreb and Zeb at the winepress of Zeb. I feel like that one's a little personal. Remember, Gideon was in the winepress. Remember, just a little personal. But anyway, while they were pursuing the Midianites, they brought the heads of Oreb and Zeb to Gideon across the Jordan. And so in chapter 7, we witness what many would know as the story of Gideon and the 300. Beating the Midianites from coward to courage. But what is the point of all of this? What is that thing that we should pull out from this text? Now look, there's a number of things that is happening here and that could take us to multiple places. But if we had limited time, which we do, what is that one thing that we should pull out of all of this? And well, it's this. Here's the point. God can and will oftentimes weaken us in order to use us. Let me say that again, because I know this is uncomfortable to hear. We don't want to serve a God who does that. So say it again. God can. Why? Because he's God. He can do whatever he wants. And so God can and will. Read the scriptures. And will oftentimes weaken us in order to use us. I mean, right out the gates, he says to Gideon, you have way too many men. If you go, then you're gonna elevate yourself. You're going to say, we did this on our own. And so God had to reduce his army. He had to reduce Gideon's army. God oftentimes will reduce your army. Now you might ask, what is my army? Your money? Your title? Your career? Your health? Whatever it is that you lean into and you go, well, look, I've done this by myself. Look how amazing I am. God can and will reduce that. And he does it for a purpose. It's so that you might trust him. That's ultimately what he wants. He wants you to trust him, to not lean on whatever it is that you're putting your trust in, but rather to lean on him. A pastor in the U.S., J.D. Greer, says this. He says, if dependence is the objective, then weakness is an advantage. If dependence is the objective, then weakness is the advantage. I think of Paul the Apostle. Many of you are familiar with this piece of scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. It's a beautiful piece of scripture. In fact, if we had time, I would read chapter 11 because it sets it up. See, in chapter 11, it's almost like Paul is going back and forth with his opponent. It's almost like a rap battle. Like they say something, he says something. They say something, he says something. And the whole time they're boasting. They're going, oh, well, you see, we're amazing at this and amazing at this and amazing at this. And Paul goes, guys, if I was to, like, if anyone should boast, it's me. So Paul said, it's me. I mean, this is Paul, a Hebrew of Hebrews. This man knew the Old Testament. Like we read, he knew the Old Testament. He says, guys, if anyone is to boast, it should be me. But you know what? I'm not going to boast about the things that you're boasting about. If I'm gonna boast, I would rather boast on my weakness. Let me read verse 12 from, or chapter 12, verse 1. It says, this boasting will do no good, but I must go on. I will reluctantly tell about visions and revelations from the Lord. I was caught up to the third heaven 14 years ago. Think about that for a moment. Like he could, you could kill a ministry. You could even call it the third heaven ministry. Book deal after book deal, speaking engagements. I mean, whether I was in my body or out of my body, I don't know. Only God knows. Yes, only God knows whether I was in my body or outside of my body, but I do know that I was caught up to paradise and heard things so astounding that they cannot be expressed in words, things no human is allowed to tell. You want me to boast? That experience is worth boasting about, but I'm not going to do that. I know this is hard to hear because I know some of us were like, no, but okay, you don't have to say everything, but maybe just one. Huh? Yeah, exactly. They must know. I'm the real deal. Especially as they come to me and they want to tell, yeah, well, you know, at the business deal I signed data. Oh, well, let me tell you, third heaven ministries. He says, I will boast only about my weaknesses. If I wanted to boast, I would be no fool in doing so because I would be telling the truth. But I won't do it because I don't want anyone to give me credit beyond what they can see in my life or hear in my message. Even though I have received such wonderful revelations from God. So to keep me from becoming proud. Other translations say it like this. To keep me from being conceited. I was given a thorn in my flesh. Satan wouldn't give something that would humble you so that you might depend upon God. No, Satan will give you so that you might boast and forget God. I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger from Satan to torment me. This is how powerful God is. Guys, we sometimes think that like the battle is between God and Satan. It's like an arm wrestle, like, oh, go, God, go. No, God is seated on his throne, fully in control, and he does whatever he wants. At any moment, he could go, you know what, I'm done, Jesus, go back, we're done. A messenger from Satan to torment me and to keep me from becoming proud. Three different times I begged the Lord to take it away. Each time he said, my grace is all you need. Please, Lord, please, please remove this. My grace is all that you need. God, please, please. You don't know how badly I need this job, how I need this promotion, how I need this increase. My grace is sufficient for all that you need. My power works best in weakness. So now I am glad to boast about my weaknesses. This is something that we don't hear a lot in the church. When people are experiencing this, they disappear. And then they come back when it's all sorted. How different would we be if on Sundays we're hearing, God, look, I'm still in the same place. But God is good. His grace is sufficient. Still don't have the job. But God is good. His grace is sufficient. Here's one. Still have the sickness. But God is good. His grace is sufficient. So now I am glad to boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ can work through me. That's why I take pleasure in my weaknesses and in the insults and hardships and persecutions and troubles that I suffer for Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong. This kind of weakness is what breeds dependence upon God. What is the point of chapter 7? We need to lean into God with everything that we are going through. God can and will often weaken us in order to use us. And that's what happens here with Gideon and his 300. They win. They have victory. And now they're pursuing the Midianites. Chapter 8, the story continues. But here's the thing about chapter 8. You see, if the story ended at chapter 7, it'd be a great story. It'd be like, wow, Gideon, amazing, from coward to courage, victory, leaned into God, was trusting him. I mean, remember chapter 6, there was always this back and forth, back and forth. He was talking to God, dependent upon God, and we see that in chapter 7. But things change in chapter 8. In chapter 8, and I hate to say this to you, because I know some of you came in here going, no, Gideon is epic, I love him. Things went sour very quickly. Chapter 8 shows us what it looks like to go from hero to zero. And it happens like this. It's quick. We're going to see some things that at first glance you'll go, no, but this still looks like good Gideon. But if we go a little deeper, you'll actually realize, no. This is not great. In fact, this is many of us. Chapter 8, verse 1. The men of Ephraim said to him, why have you done this to us? Done what? Not calling us when you went to fight against the Midianites. And they argued with him violently. Why didn't you call us? Verse 2. So he said to them, this is Gideon, what have I done now compared to you? Is not the gleaning of Ephraim better than the grape harvest of Abiezer? God handed over to you Oreb and Zeb, the two princes of Midian. What was I able to do compared to you? When he said this, their anger against him subsided. This looks like Gideon is a really, 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 really good negotiator at first glance. It looks like this is a really good conversation, and it was heated, they were upset, but you managed to bring things down at first glance. But if we were to study these verses and seek to understand everything that's happening here, we'd actually get to see that that's not what Gideon is doing. Gideon is wooing them. He's wanting to make sure that he still has the Ephraim, the tribe of Ephraim, still in his pocket. Anya, why do you say that? Well, we have to take a look at history for this. Gideon, we're told, remember, he's from the tribe of Manasseh. He's talking to some guys from the tribe of Ephraim. Joseph had two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. Joseph is one of the 12 sons of Jacob, whose name later changed to Israel. So those 12 sons became the 12 tribes of Israel. Interesting fact, Jacob actually had 13 kids. He had a daughter, her name was Dinah, right? Super interesting. But 12 sons. One of them was Joseph. Joseph had two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. Manasseh was the older brother, which meant, by Jewish custom, that when Joseph died, he was entitled to the double portion, a double portion of the inheritance. He was entitled to more. But that didn't happen. If you go read Genesis 48, you'll pick up that Jacob, grandfather, not so perfect, when he should have blessed Manasseh, he blessed Ephraim, the younger brother. We know this to be true because as we continue to read the Old Testament, we see that Ephraim is always named first, not Manasseh. That's not how it's supposed to be. If we continue to read, we will pick up that even when they went into the promised land, it was Ephraim that was given the better land, not Manasseh. This conversation here is sibling rivalry, a generational one. I can only imagine how Manasseh feels. We deserve the better land. We deserve the blessing. I am the older one. But it's always you, Ephraim. Always you. And so Ephraim has better land. Gideon says it there. He's like, but man, I mean, come on. What is it that we have that is better than you? He's wooing them. Instead of telling them the truth to say the reason we didn't call you is because God knew that you guys would say it's all about us. God knows your pride. He doesn't call them out. He woos them. I know this to be true because as we continue to read chapter 8, Gideon comes across two smaller tribes. And then he says, hey, listen, I need some help. Could you guys help my men? We're on pursuit here. We're trying to catch these guys. And they go, because they're smaller, they're going, well, you haven't caught them yet. And so we don't know how this is going to end. We're scared. He talks to them differently. And almost, how dare you? How dare you not help me? And he makes promises to them. He says, when I come back, after I've captured them, when I come back, the one, you're going to get some beatings. And the other one, he says, I'm going to tear down the tower. And he fulfills on those promises. Instead of going, hey guys, you know what? I also used to be scared. I've been where you are. But you know what? God is good. He doesn't do, he just goes, how dare you? So the one side, he's like, no, guys, listen, don't worry. It'll be fine. You know, with the wealthy, those who have more. But the ones who's like, well, you could give me nothing. I'm going to treat you differently. Be careful, friends, to think this is a Gideon thing. This is very much a us thing. Who are the people in your life who you can clearly see there is sin in their lives and you go, you know, but I don't want to call them out because I might lose X, Y, Z. I talk to so many pastors and church planters who are aware of those who are in their congregation who are wealthy, but you know what? We'll never call them out on their sin. Because they might leave the church. But then it's so easy to treat those who materially have nothing to offer and go, you know what, you only get one shot. Get out of here. The Bible calls this favoritism. I think what we call it today, what? Unconscious bias? Super weird. I don't even know what that means. The question is, but were you biased? Did you show favoritism? But let's keep going. I want to show you that things just get worse. They get worse for Gideon. They eventually capture the kings. They kill them. And then the people celebrate. All of Israel celebrates because now they are free. Let's pick up the story in verse 22, chapter 8, verse 22. It says, then the Israelites said to Gideon, rule over us, you as well as your sons and your grandsons, for you delivered us from the power of Midian. So they're super excited. This is good news. Gideon, just rule over us. Verse 23, but Gideon said to them, I will not rule over you, and my son will not rule over you. Why? Because the Lord will rule over you. Again, at first glance, this looks like, well, this is a great answer, Gideon. And at this point, the Israelites have been crying out for a king. You know, they're looking at other nations that have ruled over them, and they're going, but they have kings. Why don't we have kings? You'll see as you continue to read the Old Testament that this really comes up and becomes a massive issue. But God doesn't give them a king because he says, I am your king. They're probably going, why does God keep sending us judges? Just send us a king and we'll be good. God's going, no, I know your heart. No, I am your king. And so it looks like Gideon's reminding them of that. But if we go a little bit deeper, that's not what's happening. Ane, how do you know? I'm glad you asked. If we read on, we'll find out that Gideon got married to a number of women and had a ton of kids. And I know this keeps coming up. At some point, we're going to address this. But let me go ahead and tell you, God does not condone polygamy. He's not for it. I'm just going ahead and tell you, because I know some of you are going, hey, we're reading this quite a bit. Is that, I wonder. And then you're thinking, how am I going to have this conversation with my wife at lunch? Because, don't do it. We will at some point get to this, just not today. But Gideon has a number of wives. He has a ton of children. And then he has a concubine as well. Again, another massive issue. We'll get into it at some point. But this is wrong. Don't do it. So he has a concubine. But with this concubine, he has a son. We're given the son's name here. In verse 31, we're told that this son's name is Abimelech. Upon further investigation, we can see that his name, Abimelech, means my father is king. This is the same man who said, guys, God is your king. I'm not going to rule over you. I'm not, no. God is your king. He then names his son, my father is king. Think about this for a moment. Here's Abimelech running around, doing incredibly well. People are noticing and going, wow, look at this young man, so gifted. What is your name? My father is king. Oh, wow. Okay, who's your father? Gideon. Now, they go, Gideon? Gideon in the 300? Yes. Wow, yeah, you know, Gideon is, Gideon knew exactly what he was doing. Exactly what he was doing. Let me explain it this way. It's the same as someone naming their kid Papa Waka Kilenyor. Let me translate that. My father is Elenyora. Help me out here. What is Lenyora? Like, how do I? What is that in the English? Yeah, that's not, studying is not helpful. Guys, studying. He's a Groot man. There we go. I can always trust on you, all right? He's a Groot man. It's, and like, people would be like, so your name is what? Okay, who's your father? No, it's Orne. And then you guys will go like, yeah, no, Mar Orne. Orne is a Lenyora. Hey, studying, that guy. That guy is, I mean, it's, he knows exactly what he's doing. He's going, you know, I know I can't do this, but maybe if I do it this way, I can still get what I want, and hopefully God will be content. I mean, the last thing that he does is just, it's just absolutely horrendous. In verse 24, chapter 8, after telling them that he will not rule over them, he then said to them, let me make a request of you. Everyone give me an earring from his plunder. Now the enemy had gold earrings because they were Ishmaelites. They said, we agree to give them. So they spread out a cloak and everyone threw an earring from his plunder on it. The weight of the gold earrings he requested was 43 pounds of gold, in addition to the crescent ornaments and ear pendants and purple garments of the kings of Midian and the chains on the necks of their camels. Listen to what Gideon does now. Gideon made an ephod from all of this. What is an ephod? I'm glad you asked. You guys are asking great questions this morning. And an ephod was a garment, a priestly garment, right? It was only to be worn by the priests. Where do the priests come from? Well, they come from the tribe of Levi. Gideon is not from Levi. So he has no business doing this. But he does it. He does it. Bro, you're getting way ahead, hey, man. Stealing the thunder here. Yes. No, but he has no business in creating this garment. No business. But he does. And here's how he gets around it. Right, this was a garment, so it was a clothing. But he makes this golden, beautiful statue. And then he takes it back to the same place that he tore down the altar where his family used to worship an idol. We're told here, then all of Israel prostituted themselves by worshiping it there, and it became a snare to Gideon and his household. Friends, this is no different to what Aaron did in Exodus 32, verse 2 to 8, with the golden calf. And you notice that Gideon is now, up till now, the first judge where things go horribly wrong while he's still alive. Everyone else was like, it was epic, it was great, you know, we love God, we remember. And then after a while, after the judge died, but here, he's still alive. It is now clearer than ever that Israel's biggest problem is not out there, but it's in here. The wickedness of the human heart. And so this is what he does. He establishes himself as a king. And he says to the people that I am also your priest, king and priest. He has no business in those roles. I'll read verse 28 because it speaks so much to God's character. So Midian was subdued before the Israelites, and they were no longer a threat. The land had peace for 40 years, despite what was happening. They still experienced some sense of peace for 40 years. This speaks to God's grace. That even in the midst of their wickedness, he's still gracious enough to give peace. Now, again, what is going on here? Well, I said it up front. Let me say it again. It is easy to go from hero to zero. And it happens very, very quickly. Do you notice that in this chapter, Gideon doesn't talk to God? 6 and 7, they're talking. Here, it's just him. What he thinks, what he wants. From hero to zero. If this can happen to Gideon, friends, it can happen to us. Rooted fellowship, it can happen to us. That almost 7 years ago, we trusted God to do, at that time, what was considered the impossible. A transcultural church in the urban-suburban context of Pretoria. I would share this with people and I would be told, it'll never happen. Go to Midrand. I don't know why they were sending me to Midrand. I don't know. Is there something happening there that I'm unaware of? And so we had no other choice but to trust and to depend on God. And for a season, it looked like nothing was happening. Some of you remember, you remember you were part of those early days. It was like, man, is anything going to happen? Is this just going to be another really cool Bible study? But we just kept trusting and trusting and leaning into the presence of our Father. And then here we are. Not only are we here, but by God's grace, he's allowed us to plant 2 churches in COVID. Now, I don't want to boast in that. I want to talk about, like, man, remember this time. Why? Because then we trusted God. take courage. And then remember that season, oof, I do. But we had to trust God. Because if we don't, this is why it's important to watch our conduct. This is why it's important to examine our hearts. The Bible tells us to do this. Examine your heart and do so regularly. Where in your life are you bending the rules and telling yourself you're still good with God? Where in your life are you adding adjectives to your sin, believing that it makes it okay? A white lie. So is a green one okay? Like, what does that even mean? Like, it's still a lie. Sleeping with someone who you're not married to, your girlfriend or your boyfriend, but then saying, but we are married in our hearts. Where did you find that? Like, did you pull out married and then go somewhere else and then heart and then like and then just kind of peace and go, yeah, that's it's here. These things happen when our dependence upon God diminishes. That's what happens. We start off great. You remember when you came to faith, you were like, man, I'm all in. I'm so blown away by what God has done. I'm all in. I'm trusting him. And then over time, you start to flex a little bit. How can one tell? Onir, how can I tell if I am heading in this direction, if I'm going the way of Gideon? How can I tell? Here's a couple things. Your prayer life becomes dry. And then you begin to lean into what I call your romantic words to God. There is a difference when someone prays out of God, I need you. To God, let me woo you with these words. You know when your prayer life is dry. And here's a way to not go there is to open up God's word, read it, and then just pray these words. Just pray these words. Let your words submit to this word. Here's another thing that you could maybe pick up on in your life, and you'll see that you're heading in the way of Gideon. The word of God no longer excites you. You know, it's just, oh gosh, I got to read this. At least I'm being disciplined. I'm a disciplined human being. I just got to read it. It doesn't excite me anymore. But in this situation, dependence becomes more important than discipline. The word of God just no longer excites you. Here's another one, when generosity is a burden. Oh, I got to give of my time and my talents and my such a burden. Is that you? Here's one, when community becomes a pit hole instead of a speed hump. There's a difference. Speed humps are there to protect you and to protect others. You're going too far, slow down. Hey, we're just trying to protect you. The environment that you're in, you're going way too fast. A pit hole is just, it's like, this sucks, why is this here? Now I got to try to maneuver it, but maybe if I go quickly this way, if I try, it's an irritate, community becomes an irritation. Oh, I got to go be with those people, unbelievable. And they're going to get in my life, they're going to ask me questions. You know, it's like family group, it's like I show up and I know they're going to, so how's work? Yeah, you know, I don't know, I'm making my own decisions and now I got to tell them and I know they're going to, you know what I mean? It's an absolute irritation. There's a big one, your sin all of a sudden is not that bad. You tell yourself that. It's not. At least I'm not a serial killer. Right? That's what you say. Like, I'm not. I mean, there's people out there. You know, like, yeah, no, our marriage is, but let me tell you about so-and-so. No, no, no. God is talking to you. He's talking to you. He'll deal with so-and-so, but right now he's talking to you, to your pride and your greed and your unforgiveness. I'll give you one more. You know your dependence upon God has left the building when you're now anxious about everything. Because you're in control, it's like, I need to make sure, I need to manipulate, I need to make sure that this happens this way. I'm so anxious. It's easy to get here. Once upon a time, we were dependent upon God, trusting Him to provide a job, a raise, a spouse, a child, a miraculous healing. But then you get it, and then you're gone. Now it's the unholy Trinity, me, myself, and I. It happens so easily and so quickly. How I wish Gideon's story could have ended in chapter 7. But I'm also thankful that it's there because it's now here to show us where we could easily go. We should be the same Gideon of chapter 6 and 7. Examining our hearts, watching the conduct of our lives. Let me close Gideon's story by talking a little bit about what happens in chapter 9. And so Gideon eventually dies. And then his son, my father is king, he eventually takes over. And this man is a tyrant. He is a murderer. I mean, he ends up killing all his brothers except one. And that's simply because he ran away so he couldn't get to him. He appoints these evil men around him. He leads a mafia. He is a true dictator. Friends, let me say this real quick. We did a sermon on it in a sermon series, Emotionally Healthy Spiritual Discipleship, and so I'm not going to talk too much about it. You can go back and listen to it. But the point I want to make here is that sin loves to spread. It's like a cancer. It can even spread generationally. That's what's happening here. So we have Gideon worshiping idols and leading people astray, and then his son takes over. And go read chapter 9. It is carnage what he does. But God. Is there hope for the horrific? Verse 22 tells us that there is. It says this of chapter 9, when Abimelech had ruled over Israel 3 years, 3 years of just pain and torture, and God sent an evil spirit between Abimelech and the citizens of Shechem. God steps in. But God, is there any hope for the horrific? There is, because there is a God. Let me read how Abimelech's story ends in verse 50. From verse 50 of chapter 9, it says this. Abimelech went to Tebez, camped against it, and captured it. He's now super upset, and he is on a killing spree. He just wants to kill anyone and everyone. So he goes to this place. There was a strong tower inside the city, and all the men and women and citizens of the city fled there. They locked themselves in and went up to the roof of the tower. When Abimelech came to attack the tower, he approached its entrance to set it on fire. But a woman threw the upper portion of a millstone on Abimelech's head and fractured his skull. Thank God for women. He quickly called his armor bearer and said to him, draw your sword and kill me, or they will say about me, a woman killed him. It's too late. Here we are, still talking about it. He thought, you know what, let's sort this out. Otherwise, people are going to talk. We're talking. And we will continue to talk. So his armor bearer ran him through and he died. And when the Israelites saw that Abimelech was dead, they all went home. How crazy is that? It's almost like, oh, he's dead. Okay, cool. Now we can go home. Like, do you know what I mean? Like, it's just, oh, it's over. But hear these words. In this way, God brought back Abimelech's evil, the evil that Abimelech had done to his father when he killed his 70 brothers. God also brought back to the men of Shechem all their evil. God gets justice in the end. No matter how bad things are, God gets justice in the end. He is a God of judgment. And I know we experience a world in turmoil and pain, and it's broken, and there are evil people doing evil things. But hear me, God gets justice in the end. This can be comforting words or incredibly uncomfortable words. That choice is up to you. You can either go, I am in the covering of my father, or I'm out there waiting for God's wrath to be fully poured out on me. The wheels of God's justice grind slowly, but they grind finely. We must not mistake God's patience and long-suffering for his absence. He is patient because he wants more people to come to the saving knowledge of his son, Jesus. That even the murderer can come to faith. I want us to be a church who believes that. That even the worst person on this planet can still come to Jesus. How do we know? Because Jesus hasn't returned yet. That there is still time. And this is why week after week someone gets up here and pleads with you. We plead with you to surrender your life to Jesus. Stop playing this Jesus plus game. It's not going to work. Stop believing that you can do it on your own. It's not going to work. You cannot save yourself. You are a horrible savior. Good friend, horrible savior. Put your life in the hands of Jesus. You are loved more than you could ever imagine because of what Jesus has accomplished for you on the cross. Pleading with you. And you should be pleading with others. Do not mistake his patience and long-suffering for absence. So what is the call then? We're called to repent and believe. The band can come up as I close this out. Our call, our response is to repent and believe. And I will do that until I have no more breath left. Is to look out to you and to say, repent and believe. These aren't just fairy tales. That one day he will get full justice. And my hope is that all of you here will be with him in the safety of his arms. But if that is not you today, this very morning, this very moment, I'm pleading with you to repent and to believe. What does it mean to repent? It simply means to turn away from whatever it is that you are trusting will give you life and fulfillment and satisfaction and turn to Christ. To stop pretending and performing. God knows already. God knows that you don't have it all together. Stop telling yourself that you can pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. In the spiritual world, you don't even have boots. Turn from whatever it is that you are running to. It's an idol. It'll never give you what you need. You need a loving relationship with your Heavenly Father. So repent and believe. Come to the front. Forget what, oh, people are going to see me. And people are, just come and just, I'm laying it all down. Or come to the front and speak to someone. I just want to surrender. I want to surrender my life to Christ. God loves to save wretched, broken, pitiful people like you and I. He loves to save us. He's not looking at you and going, well, you are beyond the blood of my son. No one, no sin is beyond the grace of Jesus. And so the question is, will you repent and believe? Will you trust in him? My prayer is that this church, after we are all long gone and we're with Christ, that it would be remembered as a house that worshiped God, that praised him, that surrendered it all to him, that held nothing back. This house. Let this house be the house of the Lord. And would that then flow to where you live, work, and play? That when you show up to work, you say, the space that I'm in, this belongs to the Lord. That the community that you're in, this belongs to the Lord. Why? Because his people are there. Being salt and light. Depending on him. Calling people to repent and believe. To a Father in heaven who loves them. And so, Father God, we come to you. We come to you asking that you would do a work that only you can do. That there are folks in here who have crossed the line of faith, that they used to be orphans, but now they are children. But God, we don't have to think too long for someone to come into our minds, someone we know who has not trusted you. It may be a family member, a friend, a colleague, a neighbor. We know that they have not crossed the line of faith. And so we're asking God that you would soften their hearts right now in this very moment. You are able. You are more powerful than we could ever imagine. Draw them close to you. Our heart's desire is to worship you. It's to know you, and then it's to make you known. Make this house, Rooted Fellowship, make this house a house that belongs to you. We ask all of this in Jesus' beautiful name. Amen.
And amen. Family, we're going to respond to that message with a song of confession.